This screencast is going to cover the ideal gas equation state, give you a quick refresher on what it is, and provide an example at the end to test your abilities to use it. So an equation of state is just a relationship between the molar quantity and volume of a gas to its temperature and pressure. The ideal gas equation of state is the simplest form. We write that out as the pressure times the volume of a gas is going to be related to the moles of the gas times some gas constant we write out as R, and then the temperature T. Make sure to use the absolute pressure, and typically the units on that will be pascals, bars, atmosphere, millimeter, mercury, etc. The V stands for the volume of the gas, and the units on that will typically be liters, meters cubed, milliliters, maybe even feet cubed. And on the other side of the equation, N is going to be the moles of the gas. Typically, it's going to be written as moles, and you might see kilomoles or some other unit of moles, so make sure that you do the proper conversions when using that. Now, R is the gas constant, and it's important to use the appropriate gas constant depending on the units of your other variables. The form of the gas constant, therefore, is going to have a pressure volume units over a moles temperature units. So make sure that that is consistent and that your units are correct when using the gas constant. Typically, the gas constant can be found in any kind of properties handbook and also at the back of some of the major textbooks. And the last variable here, T, is the absolute temperature. So it's always going to be either Kelvin or degrees Rankine. Make sure that that is correct when using that. Now, while everybody hopefully is familiar with the PV equals NRT form, there's two other forms you may see or encounter in the near future. The first is if you have some kind of flow system. You may see something of the following form, where the variables for V and N have a dot above them. This stands for some kind of flow. So on the left, you're going to have a volumetric flow, and on the right, you're going to have some kind of molar flow. Now, of course, there may be another form where instead of moles, it's related to mass and molecular weight. So just something to keep in mind when we see these dots over the variables. The other form is where you might see this hat over the V. Basically, what that's doing is using the specific molar volume, V hat. Therefore, an example, units for the specific volume may be something like meter cubes per mole. Now, there are a couple of assumptions that allow us to use the ideal gas law. The first assumption is that gas molecules have a negligible volume. The second assumption is that molecules exert no force on each other. Thus, that means as molecule A is traveling along, molecule B will not exert any interaction with that path of molecule A. Now, if they crash into each other, or if molecule A crashes into a wall of the container, these collisions will occur elastically. And those are the assumptions, the basic assumptions that we use to make the ideal gas law. STP, or standard temperature and pressure, are the conditions where standard temperature is 273 Kelvin and standard pressure is 1 atmosphere. The thing about ideal gases is that at STP conditions, 1 mole of an ideal gas occupies 22.414 liters of space. And we get this by setting up our ideal gas law and plugging in the values for pressure at 1 atmosphere, unknown volume, and it's going to be equal to 1 mole of gas, again, doesn't matter what kind of gas it is, times our temperature of 273 Kelvin, times our gas constant, which in this case is going to be 0.08206. That's going to have units of atmosphere, liters, mole, Kelvin. So when we do this calculation, we get a volume of 22.414 liters. So all ideal gases, 1 mole takes up 22.414 liters. Probably a good number to remember. So let's use the ideal gas law to take a quick look at, say, breathing. We're going to simplify a lot of things here, but let's just say that we have air coming into the lung, and that's made up of just non-condensable gases, and all those gases are going to behave ideally. So what I want to propose is that if we breathe in air at room temperature, you know, room temperature typically being around 20 degrees Celsius, and that's at 1 atmosphere, and we let it equilibrate in our lungs, what's the pressure of the air going to be inside of the lungs once it reaches body temperature, which is about 37 degrees Celsius? So at this point, I would say, go ahead and give it a shot. Let me know what the pressure inside the lungs is going to end up being. And you're going to write out the ideal gas law. And you're going to say, well, we have a temperature going in, and we know the pressure going in, and we can look up a gas constant, but we don't know the volume or the amount of moles. True. So in this case, let me go ahead and give you the volume of the lungs as being 4 liters. Now we're going to go through this calculation, then I'll show you why you don't even need that. But assuming that you have now a volume of 4 liters, we could plug in for the first step to figure out the amount of moles that we breathe in, 1 atmosphere for pressure, a volume of 4 liters of air, some unknown amount of moles, a gas constant, and we're going to use that same one as we did before, which is atmosphere liters over mole Kelvin. And this is going to be times an absolute temperature, so 273 plus 20 degrees Celsius. And that's going to be Kelvin. When we do this calculation, you should get the amount of moles of air that you breathe in as 0.16695. And we're going to go ahead and round that up to 0.17 moles. So in the second case, we'll label that outlet as 2. We don't know the pressure. We know we have the same amount of volume. We're going to go ahead and make an assumption here that the lung capacity does not change. So we still have 4 liters of air. And we know that we have 0.17 moles using the same gas constant. I'm not going to write the units this time, but you should always practice to make sure that you use them right. And at this point now, the temperature has gone up to 37 degrees Celsius, 273 Kelvin plus 37 degrees Celsius. When we do it this way, we see that the pressure inside of our lungs reaches 1.06174 atmospheres, or in other words, 1.06. Now, because we make the assumption that the volume doesn't change, and we know the moles don't change, and the gas constant doesn't change, we could simply write out the following relationship. P1 times V equals NRT1. And in the second case, we do the same thing. And we could divide these two equations by each other, and we get a relationship P1 over P2 equals T1 over T2. So if we go this route, we could see that P2 is going to be equal to T2 over T1 times P1. And this comes out to 310 Kelvin over 293 Kelvin times 1 atmosphere. And that gives us the same thing we saw before, 1.06 atmosphere. So that's the pressure inside the lungs. So a question that came up recently, actually, was at lower temperatures, say freezing, 0 degrees Celsius, how is this going to affect how we hold our breath? Well, let's do these same calculations, but instead of the outside air temperature being 20 degrees Celsius, let's change this to 0 degrees Celsius. So let's use that exact relationship that we just set up before. P1 over P2 equals T1 over T2. So our P2 is going to be equal to T2 over T1 times P1. Using the new values that we have, this time over 273 Kelvin, again times the 1 atmosphere. What we're going to see this time is that the pressure is going to be 1.135 atmospheres. So at colder temperatures, it actually increases the pressure in our lungs once it reaches equilibrium in our body. So it's harder to hold your breath at colder temperatures, arguably. Of course, now we're making a lot of assumptions at the body and that the lungs aren't actually changing its volume, but gives you a quick, easy relationship using the ideal gas law. Hopefully, the screencast showed you how to use the ideal gas law to calculate some of the properties of gases given other conditions.